Is it possible to practice slow living if you're a workaholic or have a 9-to-5 job? When your main focus is making money to pay rent and put food on the table, and perhaps even taking care of the kids after that? Where are you going to find the time to slow down? In this video, I'm going to give you 5 tips that will help you to slow down, even if you have little spare time. Hi, my name is Peter Cook, and on this channel I publish videos about slow living and minimalism. So if that's something you're interested in, please subscribe to the channel. A lot of slow living information out there is not practical for people with busy lives. Yet, if you feel like you're always too busy, you can probably benefit from slowing down the most. It's like that meditation story where the teacher says,
"If you don't have the time to meditate for 1 hour every day, you should meditate for 2 hours every day."
But that's easier said than done. It seems that a lot of slow living tips come from people that are self-employed or able to work remotely and don't have kids. And hey, I myself am one of them. But I've also had a demanding high-level corporate job for many years, so I know both sides. And even though I'm now more in control of how I spend my time, I still work a lot and have workaholic tendencies. It's even a recurring topic in my bi-weekly mastermind. This is actually one of the reasons why I started this YouTube channel. By creating content about slow living, I have an incentive to educate myself about slow living to ultimately bring more slowness into my own life. We're learning together here. So, these 5 tips I'm about to share are specifically for busy people that are short on time. These are actionable tips that you can turn into practical habits to slow down, even if you have limited free time. If you feel like there aren't enough hours in the day to do everything you need to do, you may think, "I'd love to slow down, but when? And how?" Start with the time you do have control over. If you have a demanding job, constant client deadlines you need to meet, or getting the kids ready for school each morning, those are constraints on your time that you can't easily change. Leave those obligations for what they are, and focus instead on making mindful changes in areas that you do have control over. Open the door and get in the driver's seat. Take a critical look at how you spend your time. Are there time blocks in the day that you have a say over? And how do you spend those? Can you spend them more slowly? If your days are always packed and fly by, it can feel overwhelming, even paralyzing. You feel the need to slow down, but where do you even begin? I think it's important to start small. As humans, we have a built-in negativity bias. In his book, Buddha's Brain, Rick Hansen put it this way: your brain is like Velcro for negative experiences and Teflon for positive ones. This survival mechanism was helpful back in the days when we were trying to discern if that object in the far distance was a deadly lion or just a tree trunk. Those who erred on the side of caution were more likely to pass on their genes. So now we're stuck with this tendency to see things a little more negatively than they may actually be. Yes, we can be very busy. But even so, if you closely examine your day, there may very well be opportunities to slow down. What do you do during your commute to work? How do you spend your lunch breaks? How much time do you spend scrolling through your Instagram feed and watching TV? These are all moments in your day that most of us have control over and can be used to practice living more slowly. It's often small moments that can have a big impact. Maybe instead of listening to the radio or music during your commute, you can just look around and focus on your breath. On your lunch break, how about going outside and stretching your legs a bit instead of eating behind your desk? And instead of going on social media or watching the news, how about spending 10 minutes of quality time with a loved one and asking them about the day and what they are grateful for? Or if you're on your own, you can make a cup of herbal tea and sip on it while simply looking out the window. Like the other day, I saw something I probably wasn't supposed to see. 4 cats having a secret meeting on a roof nearby, plotting to take over the world. I hope I'm not getting into trouble for sharing this. Jokes aside, what really matters is, are you giving it your full attention? Slow living is really about bringing awareness to what we do moment to moment and appreciating it. And it starts with these little moments in our day that we can choose to slow down and bring more balance in our lives. Feel a sense of purpose, of well-being. This may even have a ripple effect into the parts of your day that are outside of your control. One thing you have control over is your screen time. Many of us are looking at screens all day for work. But in our free time, that just continues. We grab our phone first thing in the morning. Maybe you're someone who scrolls through their Instagram feed at night, sitting on the couch, pretending to simultaneously watch Netflix on TV. And even if you put that phone away, if you have notifications turned on, it's back in your hand in no time. Put your phone on airplane mode an hour before going to bed. And even better would be to also not watch TV or open your laptop. Use this time to do something that slows you down. Have a conversation with your partner about the day. Play a board game or do a puzzle. Or read a book. Light a candle and ponder life's big questions. Or just do nothing. I mean, these are just some ideas that come to mind, but anything goes really. What matters is that you break the habit of being glued to your screen all day long. You will sleep better too. I know this from personal experience. For years, the last thing I would do before going to bed was check and react to emails on my phone. And it was the first thing I did when waking up. And I had so much trouble falling asleep. It would often take me at least an hour. I learned the hard way that it's important to be vigilant with how you spend your time. And if you want more slow living in your life, this is a simple yet doable way to do it. Then, in the morning, first take a moment to wake up and do some activities that wake you up and make you feel good. Exercise, shower, make a cup of coffee. This doesn't have to take up a lot of time. Even just 5 minutes could do it. But it's the intention that counts. By starting your day this way, you're laying the foundation for the day ahead. Another way to slow down when you're busy is to unitask. In my video, What is Slow Living, which I will link to up here, I debunked the myth that if you live more slowly, you can't get anything done. But one thing that will lower your productivity is constantly switching between tasks. You've probably heard that we can't multitask. That what's really happening is that we're just constantly switching between the different tasks that we're trying to do simultaneously. The thing is, that's only true to a certain extent. We can multitask surprisingly well when it comes to habits. Even more so when the tasks are unrelated. For example, you can easily do the laundry and think about that difficult problem you need to solve for a client at the same time. But when it comes to tasks that require conscious thought, unitasking is key. It is not possible for us to seamlessly switch attention from one task to another. When we shift from one task to the next, fragments of the previous task remain in our attentional space. This is called attention residue, a term coined by Sophie Leroy, Associate Professor of Management at the University of Washington, in a 2009 paper, Why Is It So Hard to Do My Work? Writing a document, then reading and replying to an incoming urgent email, discussing an upcoming presentation with a colleague, then back to the letter. When you switch activities like that, your attention is split, with part of it still focused on the previous task. In our study, Leroy found that attention residue led to poor performance on the next task. Constantly switching between tasks is exhausting, and it also takes longer to finish a task than if you could give it your undivided attention. So how can you minimize the negative impact of attention residue? If a project has an urgent deadline, it just has to get done, attention residue or not. But maybe you also have pressure or deadline-free projects. Block out time to work on it without interruption. Close your office door if you can, and if you have a secretary, ask them to only interrupt you if urgent calls or emails come in. In his book Deep Work, Cole Newport writes that this type of focused work, where you're immersed deeply in something challenging, can get you into a flow state, which has been shown to generate happiness. If your job doesn't allow you to block out time like this, think about how you can take control and change part of your workday to single task. Maybe you can control when to take a break. And you can take a break after finishing a task and before starting a new one. Or maybe you need to have a conversation with your boss to discuss your options, which ties into tip one, taking charge by focusing on what you can control. Another way to reduce attention residue is to slow down during your commute. Instead of checking emails and ruminating about work, make a conscious decision to leave the stress of work at the office for today. And instead, be intentional about how you want to enter the home. If you had a bad day at work, would you want your family to see you in a bad mood, all tensed up? What if you could walk in feeling calm and open to your loved ones? I know that can be difficult, especially when you're still fuming about something that happened at work. But it all starts with intention. It's these small moments in the day that we can control and take ownership of that can ultimately really make a massive difference in how we feel at the end of the day. This tip is specifically for parents with young children, and I took inspiration for this one from Carl Honoré's 2004 book, In Praise of Slowness. In it, he writes about the nightly tug of war he had with his 2-year-old son. His son wanted dad to read long stories at a gentle pace, but to Honoré, it was an item on the to-do list that he just tried to rush through. So he picked the shorter books and read them quickly. Already thinking about the next thing, whether it was checking emails or paying bills. And then one day he read an article about the book, The 1-Minute Bedtime Stories. These are classic fairy tales condensed into 60-second sound bites. That sounded fantastic. But his next thought was, have I gone completely insane? He had this insight, this realization that he was always in a hurry and missing out on life. It inspired him to write his book on slow living. So if you're a busy parent, maybe you can relate to this story. What if you would use this valuable time with your little one to practice living more slowly? Instead of ruminating about your coworker's comment from earlier today, or stressing out about not being able to finish that work project tomorrow, leave those worries at the bedroom door. Before walking into your child's bedroom, take a few deep breaths and set the intention to be present. Leave your phone outside, you could even take off your watch. And then as you walk in, slow down and keep an open mind. You could even imagine a string connecting your heart and theirs. Children can tell when you're not present with them. They need us to slow down to their tempo. You can't set an internal timer and give them 5 minutes to open up to you. But if you can give them your full attention, 10 minutes into the story, they may all of a sudden share something that happened when they were playing outside today. And all of a sudden, you have this very meaningful conversation. And over time, these bedtime stories might even become the highlight of your day, the reward you're looking forward to. It worked for Carl Honoré. In his TED Talk, which I will link to in the description below, he shared that he had now slowed down to his son's pace when reading a bedtime story. One time, when he was about to leave for a book tour, his son gave him a card to award him for being the best story reader in the world. Now, isn't that worth more than any other item on your to-do list? Okay, so the final tip I have for you to slow down as a busy person is to set a timer twice a day. When it rings, stop what you're doing and check in with yourself. Here are some questions you could ask yourself. What am I thinking about or doing right now? How does my body feel? Are my shoulders tensed? How long have I been sitting in the same position? Could I do something different to slow down? You can do this any time of the day, even during times that you don't have control over, because it will only take a minute. But it's important, because with each time break, you remind yourself of your intention to live more slowly. Being busy is the default mode for many, and it can feel like there isn't enough time in the day. However, what we do with the time we have can make all the difference. It's those little moments that we take during the day to slow down that can make everything else seem so much more bearable and have a ripple effect on the things that we don't have control over. In the end, slow living is not about how much free time you have, but about how you spend the time that you have control over. And then, in that time, being intentional and prioritizing things that are truly important. One thing I'd like to add is that, although these tips can be helpful in bringing moments of slowness into your life, they can't fix serious problems that need to be addressed. If you're in a job that sucks all the energy out of you, if you have serious health issues, or maybe you're in a pretty toxic relationship, a few slow living quick fixes aren't going to cut it. That would be like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. In that case, forget about the band-aid and first work on the root of what's troubling you. So, I hope you found these slow living tips helpful. Maybe only some are a good fit for your particular situation. Take what you find helpful and leave the rest. And if you have something valuable to add that I didn't mention, please leave a comment with your slow living tips. That way we get to inspire each other, as well as the other viewers. And if you want to help this video reach more people, then you can do that by hitting the like button and subscribing to the channel. These are clear signs to YouTube that people are enjoying this video, and it will then promote it to other people. Thanks so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video.